Okay, very good morning, everybody. Today is the last day of our third season of presentations. And today you are going to make presentations on cultural studies. We are carrying out this presentation in a unique mode, in a mixed mode or a hybrid mode of presentation. First time we are trying this. And I would like you again to have a look at the setting here in the lab, which is made for this presentations. Okay, so yeah, this is how the arrangements are made. The students sitting here, and they are physically present, and there are many who are present in an online mode also. So in this way, the presentations are being made. There is a podium there. You see there the podium where the presenter, those who are coming here physically, they stand near the podium and make their presentations. And somehow it worked very well for all 5 days, except for the first day we had no other problems. And so far electricity was also good, internet also worked very well for all 5 days, full day, almost 5 to 6 hours in both the sessions we were working. And so it worked in a interesting way. So it also is good to see that the internet provided by the university here has been quite reliable for all 4 days. આમ તો આપણે જે વખાણ બહુ કરીએ એટલે વસ્તુ બગડે, એટલે વખાણેલી ખીચડી દાઢે વળગે. સો લેટ અસ હોપ ધેટ ટુડે ઓલ્સો ધેર વોન્ટ બી એની પ્રોબ્લેમ હિયર એન્ડ વી વિલ બી એબલ ટુ હેવ અ સક્સેસફુલ ડે હિયર. And today, the banner for the day, today we have just a minute, let me share. Yeah, so this is 19th October, batch 2020-22, presentation season 3, and today you are going to make your presentations on cultural studies, various aspects of cultural studies you are going to make your presentations on. And the students who are going to make a presentation today are, here is the list and their topic. So we'll start with Pina, and Pina will deal with Marxist theory with examples of Titanic movie and Avatar. Stuti will deal with a study of Hamlet in cultural studies. Sneha will deal with cyber feminism. Riddhi on why are we so scared of robots or artificial intelligence. Niyati on 5 types of cultural studies. Niti, eco-criticism, depiction in Indian English literature. Nanditaba on cultural studies, different aspects of it. Lata on Gayatri Spivak and the Subaltern. Kishan on Chetan Bhagat and his market. Let me remind you that you make your titles properly here, because this title we are going to use in the description of the video recording, which will be uploaded on YouTube. So make your title significant and quite correct. Like Nandita, you still need to work. Cultural studies is with different aspects is not looking quite well as a sentence structure. So that needs to be reworked. Nidhi, the space before the colon should not be there, it should be after the colon. Eco-criticism, colon space depiction there. Okay, so in other previous also you make your edit in the title properly. So in the description it looks very significant. All these titles will be directly copy pasted in the description. And you all have submitted your presentations in Google Classroom, and we are going to overview your presentations with the help of a rubric which we have prepared, where we will judge your subject knowledge, organization of your arguments and ideas, your verbal skills, that is elocution, art of clear speaking, mechanics of your writing. Also, we will see whether you are making errors, spelling errors or grammatical errors in your slides or not. And in non-verbal, we'll see eye contact, your body language and enthusiasm, which we have suggested you to maintain the eye contact with camera when you speak, which still we are seeing that you are not able to maintain in the screenshots and other photographs. When we see, we find that you are constantly reading the screen rather than facing a camera also. So that still we need to work. We hope that by in semester four, you will do a lot of other practice. You will observe your videos. And by looking your videos, video recordings, you will learn that still you need to maintain a proper body language, eye contact and enthusiasm. So in semester four, I think we will see an improvement in this aspect. And the research aspect, we try to look at the citations, your originality of writing, which we know that we need to work a lot on originality of writing, because the CCP technology, cut, copy, paste, is widely used by the students in various work that they do. So it's one of the very challenging tasks for all the teachers today, to how to battle with the research writing or academic writing, or any kind of thinking activities when it comes to the digital production, because things are easily available to students, and students are easily directed to take things, ready-made sources from various things, instead of thinking on their own or thinking originally about those ideas. And MLS citations, which we are planning here to work on. Okay? So that is the significant thing which we'll see through our rubric. Today we also will try to see that on a political compass task that we have given to you as a part of your aptitude for cultural studies, where do you stand? So one test was given to you to look into that, and how well have you fared in this test, that also we will have a look at. We are going to start with Pina. So let me open her political compass certificate to just have a look at how the things will be there and what we are trying to highlight in this. So yeah, this is the political compass, and this is still, you have not changed, Pina. Yesterday I suggested you you can read the comment. Can you read the comment, you all of you in the shared screen? I have put a comment there to last night, 10:44 p.m. because this certificate was generated in 2019. And so I have told that do not take the shortcut for submitting the old work. Do it again. You have done this several times in submitting your work. So because you have taken a drop for 1 year and you have joined after 1 year, some of the topics which were common in semester two are again repeated in semester three. Now, in that case, what you should do is that you should be doing the work in the best possible way, that we can suggest other students that do it like Pina, because you are doing it second time. So your quality obviously should improve. But instead of that, you are taking a shortcut of submitting the old work only in many of your online tests also you have done that. In many of your thinking activity also you have done that. And here also you have not changed. So I didn't like to tell this openly when things are recorded. But if you have not changed, then what can I do? I am helpless. I have to pinpoint, because even if the message was given, even after 12 hours of the message, you have not changed. So I have to highlight this, that in this semester several times this is done, which should be avoided. Obviously you get a good chance to rework and perform in a better way. So why don't you take that chance to do better rather than repeat the same kind of things? Okay, but this is one political compass which you will see, which tries to speak about whether you are leftist, rightist, whether you are authoritarian, or you are libertarian. How libertarian you are, or authoritarian, opposite, or whether you are left oriented or right oriented. You can see where is Mahatma Gandhi. You can see where is now. See here, you won't be able to see the recent people. For example, if I have to again have to open another one, the latest one, perhaps I will have to open, which we are going to see that there is also why it is necessary to do the latest thing, because things keep on updating. Now, such simple things, I don't know how many times we need to tell people to see that things will keep on changing, and you have to see that this updates. Now, here you will see our Prime Minister Narendra Modi also in this. Now, that you will not see in the previous, the older version. Yeah. Now, see here, you will see Donald Trump. Yes. Whereas in this, you will see Joe Biden also, along with Donald Trump, you will see Joe Biden also. So, Joe Biden also was absent. Narendra Modi also was absent. So that also is very significant to be seen. Okay, but we will try to see. I hope you might have got some idea about what this is. If not, then today evening, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, you have lot many days to think what is this. And then you can ask a question also, so that I can explain or give an answer on that also. Well, along with this, we are also going to see your work that you have submitted throughout the semester. So, in Google Classroom, which will give us a grade book. Yes, so, in the grade, this Google Classroom will identify the work that is submitted by the students. Work done on time, late submission, missing task. That also we will get as a list here. So, that also we are going to overview that whether your work is complete or not in this grade book, along with today's work also. So today is as such a last day for us in this third semester. Now we are directly going to meet in fourth semester, and as it will continue either in hybrid mode or online and offline mode. So I don't think that I will be able to see all of you together until the end of semester four, when you will come to submit your dissertations and other kinds of thing, or presentations. We will not be able to see you. So today we can give you as many instructions as possible. Otherwise, many things are not reaching to many of you. You are not reading carefully WhatsApp messages also, or even Google group messages are also not read. That's why Stuti has not completed the work. And many times we have seen that we have shared video or other thing to be seen, but is not seen by everybody. That is the reality. As you know that now we easily get a digital footprints. If I share a blog link or a YouTube link, and then I see that there are only 3-4 students who have seen, it means that the entire class has not seen those things. That is how we get the proof that students are not accessing the materials shared by teachers over either WhatsApp group or Google group or through any other modes also. Some of the limitations of this distance learning or online is very visibly seen in our study in last 2 years, 1.5 years you are with us in this journey of online and offline, and many of the limitations are very glaring limitations that we have seen. Many of you were earlier suggesting that why our university is not going for online exam. Now you can understand that ama online ma jaiye to bada chori j kare, cut copy paste sivai kahi koi na kare, એટલે આપણે એને લાયક છે કે નહીં ઓનલાઈન પરીક્ષાને, એ પ્રશ્ન જે મોટો પ્રશ્ન દરેક શિક્ષણવિદોને હોય છે કે શું કામ બધાને એક ડબ્બામાં પૂરી અને પરીક્ષા લેવી જોઈએ આ બધાને, શું કામ એક ડબ્બામાં પૂરવામાં આવે અને સુપરવાઇઝર બરાબર ધ્યાન રાખે, હલી ચલી પણ ન શકે, પેન્સિલ પણ બાજુમાંથી માગી ન શકે, કાંઈ પણ જોવા જાય એટલે કોપી કેસ કરી જ દેવાનો, પણ આપણે કદાચ એને જ લાયક છે. દેટ ઓલ્સો વી હેવ એક્સપિરિયન્સ. આપણે આ પણ અનુભવ્યું છે કે આપણે કદાચ આને જ લાયક છે, એટલે આપણે હવે કોઈને સજેસ્ટ ન કરી શકીએ કે તમે થોડા પ્રોગ્રેસિવ થઈને ઓનલાઈન પરીક્ષાઓ લો અમારી. આપણે એ એક નૈતિક બળ ગુમાવી ચૂક્યા છે. આપણે એક મોરલ કરેજ જે હોય એ આપણે અનુભવ્યું છે 1.5 વર્ષમાં કે આપણે આમાં એ ગુમાવીએ છીએ. અને એટલે GTUN જે પરીક્ષા લીધી એ બધામાં એ લોકો નાસીપાસ થયા છે. ગુજરાત યુનિવર્સિટી GTU કે 90%, 100% રિઝલ્ટ આવે અને બધાને એમ થાય કે ધીસ ઇઝ ધ કલ્ચર, ઇઝ ધીસ ધ કલ્ચર ઓફ ઇન્ડિયન યુથ. કારણ કે આજે આપણે કલ્ચરલ સ્ટડીઝ ઉપર વાત કરવાની છે. એન્ડ એવરી ડે લાઈફ ઇઝ વોટ વી સ્ટડી એન્ડ વી હેવ એક્સપિરિયન્સ લોટ મેની થિંગ્સ અબાઉટ ધ કલ્ચર ઓફ ધ યુથ ઓલ્સો. ઓકે, સો નાવ લેટ અસ સ્ટાર્ટ વિથ ધ ફર્સ્ટ પ્રેઝન્ટેશન. ઓકે, સો પીના, યુ કેન સ્ટાર્ટ વિથ યોર પ્રેઝન્ટેશન. You can just a minute. Yeah. Okay. Now you can start. Yeah. Unmute your mic. Yeah. Unmute your mic.
Good morning to all of you. So today, the last and fifth day of presentation semester 3, the paper number 5, culture study, in which I have dealt with the topic the study of Marxism theory with example of Titanic and Avatar movie. So I would like to share my screen here. It is visible.
You can share this tab.
Now visible. Okay, so my topic is study of Marxism theory with example of Titanic movie and Avatar. So first of all, we discuss about what is the Marxism. So Marxism is a social, political and economic theory originated by Karl Marx, which focus on the struggle between capitalist and the working class. Karl Marx, his most famous work is Das Kapital, in which he described the struggle between three classes, the aristocrat class, middle class and upper class. And also Matthew Arnold also discuss about these three classes in his essay, Culture and Anarchy. He discussed about the struggle of three class, the barbarian, philistine, and populist class. Marx wrote that the power relationship between capitalist and worker were inherently exploitative and would inevitably create class conflict. He believed that this conflict would ultimately lead to a revolution in which the working class would overthrow the capitalist class and size control of the economy. Capitalist society is made up of two classes, the bourgeois or business owner, who control the means of production, and the proletarian or workers, whose labor transform raw commodities into valuable economic goods. These are the main Marxist critics, Terrell Angleton, who is the most famous English literary theorist, critic, and public intellectual, and his most famous work is Marxism and Literary Criticism in 1976. Another one is Karl Marx. So Karl Marx was one of the most famous Marxist critic, who is a German philosopher, critic of political economic, and his most famous work is Das Kapital. Another one is Frederick Jameson. Frederick Jameson was an American literary critic, philosopher, and a Marxist political theorist, and his most famous work is Marxism and Form, 1971. Marxism within film. So Marx explained how society is a complex structure based on the relationship of power between the different sections of society. He also said how media is still seen as a part of this structure. And because of that, Marx's critique of film is a good critical approach when viewing film. Way of looking film. Marxism is now one of the main way of looking at film, and has taken over a form liberal pluralism as the dominant perspective of looking at film. As a Marxism offer a critique of liberal pluralism, this is a big question. Liberal pluralism is defined as when people are able to operate freely within society, and media is used as a form of free expression. Marx theory can be seen within many films. Applying Marxist theory in the Titanic movie. So Titanic movie is one of the a good example of the study Marxism. Titanic makes the Marxist class struggle obvious, and it is one of the most obvious film which portrayed a difference in class and struggle between them. It is also a great example of capitalism. So now I'm going to explore some different element of the film in the Titanic and Avatar movie. The ship. The Titanic itself is a symbol of capitalism and greed. The way of owner of the ship were striving to make the ship faster, stronger, and more luxurious for the upper classes is a representation of what Karl Marx meant when he was talking about materialism, and he said that if ever there was an industrial creation that served little purpose other than creating a new mode of gratification. So the ship is itself show the class struggle, showing the first class passenger on the upper decks and the third class passenger unable to reach the higher decks. So this is a good use of a positioning as a metaphor for the struggle the proletariat has the reaching of the highest of the ruling classes. The character is for the two main character in the Titanic movie, Rose and Jack. They are a complete opposites. Rose is a rich young woman and who has everything she would want, where Jack has nothing. At the beginning of the film, he is trying to gamble his way to America by trying to win third class tickets in the pocket games. The top deck scene is a great example of how the class difference is shown in Titanic. In these scenes, everyone is dressed in either top that and tails or in a gown, while Jack is wearing tatty clothes suitable for his class, and he is the only one slouching. You can see how the idea that the upper class member are set up straight, where Jack is causally. The way the different classes are treated by the bourgeois is obvious in this scene depicting the sneaking of the ship, where the ruling class order that the third class passenger are to be located in the lower decks, while the first class passenger have the chance to get aboard the lifeboat. The character themselves show how the different classes can work together and are not totally exclusive, but only can work together if they are willing to over or and are in a crisis, and how in general life the proletariat are forced and manipulated into the what the bourgeois or the ruling class want. This is a good example of what Karl Marx said about how socialism can rise up in the face of a capitalist oppression. Avatar was a good example of the study of Marxism theory. Avatar movie directed and written by James and in 2009, Avatar was described as a young tank, as a Marxist saga on the far distant planet. It is one of the only film to show how Marxist idea in a film can be reflected literary in real society. In January 2010, the Chinese government banned Avatar, despite it is a popularity. People have speculated that this is because the film shows the rise of socialism and how it can overcome capitalist nature. This is shown within the film as the Navy fight against the human population, and is speculated that people may think they can rise up against the current regime and have a similar situation as in Avatar appear in China. So this may should extreme, but it has happened. In 2010, Palestinian activities in the West Bank dressed up as an Avatar and protest against the Israeli population of the area. And the barrier built across their land. Even while they were dressed up, Israelis gazed the protester while they were demonstrating near the border. Five elements of mice and scenes apply into the movie Titanic. Through the content analyzing finding show that the film Titanic has a successfully with well done of mice and scenes elements. These five mice and scenes elements are mise and scenes elements are acting, style, setting, space arrangement, and costume and lighting. All the above element was applied into the film Titanic to enhance the storyline and also make the story run smoothly. Based on the finding of content analyzing in this chapter 4, the setting in the in this film has created the contrast between higher and lower classes. This vivid acting style by the several main and supporting character has enhanced the storyline and also made the story run smoothly. Lighting in this film has created meaning in all scenes. The mood has enhanced through different lighting in several scenes. The costume in this film is functional in telling audience that the different characteristic of the character in the scenes. It is also enhanced the contrast class level in this film. Space arrangement in this film has given the meaning to the particular scenes through different camera placement and camera shot. So these five mise en scene elements in the film Titanic is the important key to make this film successfully and memorable. These are the work citation. Thank you.
Okay, you can stop presenting. And yes, a quick questions to her.
Hello, Pina. My question is, what are the key concepts of Marxism?
Stuti, please repeat your question.
What are the key concepts of Marxism?
So the key concept of Marxism is the dialecting materialism, commodities, capitalism, labor, the working class alienation, means of a communication, the general general intellectual ideology, socialism and communism and class struggle. These are the key concept of Marxism.
We are taking one question only today, okay? So we can see other things and save over time also. Okay, so Pina's work, we can see here that you have scored 87.64% in the Google Classroom performance. So it is above the average of class. Your class average is 85. So if you are above 85, it is good. But if you are below 85, then it is problematic. And only one work is missing. Yes, one work on film studies. Yes. A film study, study of film or a scene or a in this one, no? So you're not given the link. Link is, so it is pending work. No? So one work is pending that you have to complete as early as possible. Okay, fine. And your in your this test, this political compass test, what was your test? Here it was. Okay, so you also need to take a new test, not 19. The date is coming there. So it should be 21, October 21 should be there. So this will not work. Okay, so in the next one, we will try to analyze this also. But your red dot is your stance, whether you are on the right wing side or a left wing side, whether you are authoritarian or libertarian. So what you are, that red dot will display that you are this kind of personality type when it comes to your opinions on various cultural aspects, economical aspect, cultural aspect, then whether you are right wing, left wing, authoritarian or libertarian. Okay, next presenter is Stuti. Yes.
Niyati, please share my screen.
Yes, today I am share the your.
Okay. Hello, good morning everyone. Today I'm going to presentation of paper number 5, cultural study, and my topic is cultural study practice in study of Hamlet. Second slide. What is cultural study? Cultural include the organizations of productions, structure of the family and structure of the institute, which governs social relationship, the characteristic from thought which a member of the society communications. Next. Cultural study of Hamlet. Cultural study examines power relationship. Also, it emphasizes on its, for the example, cultural study and its critics as a zoom opposition's role wherever they might be found. And Hamlet is written by Shakespeare. Shakespeare play, and this is a tragedy or revenge play. Hamlet is the most important character of very different of the novel. Hamlet is the story of prince of Denmark, and Hamlet who want to take revenge by his father's death and by his uncle Claudius. Shakespeare also changed entire story with making his Hamlet, and in this play some marginalized character we have not been given enough importance, and those who should have been recognized in their lives. Hamlet is play within the play. In this play, main hero and power positions of Hamlet. Theme of Hamlet. Here are brief accounts of selections of the major Hamlet themes: revenge, corruptions, religious, politics, appearance and reality, and woman. Next. Hamlet belong to royal family. He was intelligent and educated with proper understanding. Hamlet knew politics of power, indeed, on all matter that deeply affect people practical and day-to-day life. And here, show power is important over life. So if you have money, that time you identity or man, and give positions. Show the people who have money and power positions, they will be given importance. And Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are marginalized character. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern is a major character in the play. Next. Speech of Rosencrantz. The singular end life is bound with the highest end armor of the mind. We keep itself from nines, but more the spirit spirit of honor, whose well depend and rest the leaves of money. The case is majesty is dies not alone, but like a gulf. Don't draw near it, which it sights F fixed on the summit of the highest mound, and attend the boisterous rain, and never alone did the king side, but with a general ground. Marginalized character in Hamlet, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. The meaning of the name, the meaning of the name is different or hardly match what seem to be the essential of there. The name of Rosencrantz meaning is the garland of rose, and Guildenstern meaning is a golden star. To say that the mighty struggles between antagonists is the stuff of the of this play. He's hardly original, but overemphasized in the present reading. Is that one can gain a further insight into the play. Both are distinctly plot driven, empty of personally aside, is sign of antique in the snivelly way, angle to curry favor with power, even if it means a point or point on their erstwhile friends. Next, the meaning of their name, and hardly Hamlet recent request and guidance. Guildenstern are depicted in the central window of the group called Hamlet greets the play. Next, the passage is a thoughtful and in image equally successful passage. Worthy of the wise and accomplished statement, but many readers and viewers of the play work rank. The passes based soliloquy play within the play. Next, what is to be understood in? It is necessary to enrich our response to Hamlet by looking at the related cultural and philosophical manifestations from the 20th century. And in the 20th century, the date our never living and Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, whereby Tom Stoppard in the fascinations are seeing of their existence over it lake. It is not that essence of marginalized in here. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are archetypal human being. In this play, powerless Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Next, what is cultural study want? Cultural study giving us a view from history and cultural scholar even or incident. Marginalized character had been ignored. third Nobel characters third Nobel characterized had been super spy of having morality and high moral value. Where is hero from a royal and wealthy family? Described and a noble character in spite of a king is moral and in a sentence people so cultural study want to have a look at this marginalized character. Next, Hamlet legs. Hamlet has many legs. Hamlet is many legs. For example, he is a chance to kill Cloudy while praying to God. God Hamlet think that if he kills Cloud, now then he will differently go to heaven because he is praying to God. But if he had killed Cloudy, at that time, then he would not have killed innocent Polonius. And Hamlet does not think of these two best friends with who he has spent a lovely time and described to put an end to their death. Next. Conclusion. Instructive to note that the reality of power reflective of Shakespeare time and in another cultural reflective radically different world view, but overemphasized in the reading can gain a further insight into the play and indeed into Shakespeare's cultures by thinking not about king and prince, but about the lesser person caught up in the massive oppositions. Next, here is the work citation. Thank you.
Okay, so we're not going for the question to her, but a few things let me share. Have you prepared the slides on your own or Shruti?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so there are a lot many errors in this. I'm listening her here, so no need to. So lots of spelling error. Now, it is good that you prepared. So, aap bhul che pardonable che. Sidhu cut copy paste karu. Koi naam aasi ena karta hai. Bhul bharelu lakhu saru. So, in that way, it is good. Whatever you write is better than you just cut copy paste from any other source. But at the same time, you also have to see that how you will improve your language from the simple mistakes that you are making. So, even in this paragraph, their noble characteristic had being super said. See, this all, it's not an English language. And English language na thi aage biju che. Spelling ne bol che, sentence structure ne bol che. In spite of having morality and high moral will, where is hero from royal and wealthy families? Koi full stop na thi aavtu, comma na thi aavtu, kahin j nahi. એટલે ક્યાં અટકવું વાંચતા વાંચતા એ પણ ખ્યાલ ના આવે. That all you need to work on that. Even here also, Hamlet lacks. Okay, fine. Then semicolon પાછો નીચે આવી ગયું છે. કોઈ સ્માઈલી મૂક્યું હોય ને એવું લાગે છે. લેગ્સ માંથી પછી પેરેગ્રાફ માં લેગ બની ગયું. Hamlet has many legs.
The spelling mistake.
હા હા સ્પેલિંગ મિસ્ટેક, બટ ઇટ ઇઝ લાઈક ઇટ ગિવ્સ અનધર મીનિંગ કે જાણે હેમ્લેટ કોક્રોચ બની ગયો હોય, એને ઘણા બધા પગ ફૂટી નીકળ્યા હોય. So this all W Wild, you see this. See now all your presentations, you edit it once and then upload. તમે આજ બધું અપલોડ કરી દેશો, કાલે જોશે કે આ ભાવનગર યુનિવર્સિટીના વિદ્યાર્થીઓ આવું લખે છે, એમએ ના વિદ્યાર્થી. બીજા કોઈની અરજી પણ રિજેક્ટ કરી દેશે. તમે તો અરજી નહીં કરો ક્યાંય, બીજા કોઈ અરજી કરશે તો પણ યુનિવર્સિટીનું નામ પડશે, તા રિજેક્ટ થશે. સો સી ધીસ, એડિટ કરી અને અપલોડ કરો, એડિટ યોર થિંગ્સ એન્ડ ધેન અપલોડ એન્ડ ટ્રાય ટુ ઇમ્પ્રુવ ધીસ લેંગ્વેજ એરર, સિમ્પલ એરર, વર્ક ઓન ઇટ. કામ કરશો તો ઓટોમેટિક ઇમ્પ્રુવ થઈ જશે ઇફ યુ વિલ વર્ક ઓન ધેટ. બટ ઇટ ઇઝ ગુડ યુ આર નોટ કટ કોપી પેસ્ટિંગ, દેટ ઇઝ ઓલ્સો ગુડ. ઘણા લોકો બધું સીધું ઉઠાંતરી કરીને લઈ લે છે, એના કરતા ભૂલ થાય એ સારું. Okay, then your work in this, so you have 62% overall, that is very much low than the Google Classroom average, that is 85%. So it means that you have performed very low in the class, that is what it tries to say. But your work is complete by and large, so two works are pending. One is on film studies, another is on Khan Academy deconstructionism. So complete these two work as early as possible, and the other work which is now given allotted, and we have extended the time, so that is remaining as assigned work. That also you see that you have not taken the test, so test you have to take, and that also you have to submit as early as possible. Okay, fine. So the next presenter is Neha.
Good afternoon, everybody. Today, in the paper of cultural studies, I would like to present on the topic of cyber feminism. So for that, I would like to share my screen. Visible it's okay. So, cyber feminism. So, introduction. Women's empowerment is a multi-dimensional social process consisting of components like feeling of self-worth, their right to settle on choices, their right to have ingress to prospects and resources, their right to have the authority to manage and direct their individual life and lives, and their propensity throughout the directions of social conversation, of fashion more imperial and just social and economical order, not only nation but also universally. So background of the cyber feminism, that the term cyber feminism was first used around 1991 by both the English cultural theoretician Sadie Plant and the Australian artist group VNS Matrix, independently from each other. So it was the third wave feminism. It's tended to include mostly younger technology save women and those from Western white middle class backgrounds. For example, that although women had been involved in the creations and development of the computer, their contributions largely marginalized and their participation often ignored or written out of history. So the famous cyber feminist Plant, she argued that women are naturally suited to using the internet because women and the internet are similar in nature. According to Plant, our non-linear self-replicating system concerned with the making connection. She has argued that although previous feminists have believed computer to essentially male, we should instead see computers and the internet as a places for women to engage in new forms to work and play where women are freed from the traditional constraint and are able to experiment with identity and gain new avenues in forcoming power and authority. The origin of the movement are cloudy. In 1985, the famous cyber feminist Donna Haraway published the cyborg manifesto, an essay in the Socialist Review. Haraway's ideas were radical. She called for she called for a rejection for rigid boundaries between humans and animals, and asserted that the cyborg is a creature in a post-gender world. Technology was redrawing the boundaries of identity. So VNS matrix in the heady early years of the World Wide Web for Australian women like Josephine Stairs, Julian Pierce, Francie Cardi Remini, and Virginia Barrett made Fierce and Funny Feminist art under the name VNS Matrix. They were part of a cultural movement called cyberfeminism, and which picked up early 1990s and dissipated sometime between the bursting of the dot-com bubble and the coming of Y2K. What is the cyberfeminism? So according to Cornelia Solfrank from the in her work Old Boys Network States Network, she states that cyberfeminism is a myth, and a myth is a story of undefeatable origin or of different origins. A myth is based on one central story which is retold over and over in a different variations. A myth denies one history as well as one truth, and implies a search for truth in a space. In the difference between the different stories, speaking about cyberfeminism as a myth is not intended to mystify it. It simply indicates that cyberfeminism only exists in a plural. Who are the cyberfeminists? Famous is the Donna Haraway, Faith Wilding, Cornelia Solefrank, Linda DeMent, Melinda Peckham, and Shu Li Ching, whose 1998 Way project Brandon was the Guggenheim Museum's first foray into collecting interest-based art. So cyberfeminism in today's context, that today feminist movements are organizations have gone for beyond women's rights and human rights by intentionally practicing more in intersectionality and expanding the idea of women's rights and women's issues to a feminist political framework that is applied to issues ranging from climate justice to drug policy. During this time, technology has drastically altered the landscape of human rights. Social movements and human rights organizations are struggling to deal with human rights violations that are being facilitated and perpetuated by those in power and their technology. Tech corporations are more powerful than many governments around the world. So feminist activity, this is from one article, Feminist Activism on Digital Platform in India. And according to Shruti Jain, using digital tools, feminists have appropriated the internet culture with the use of humor and other creative satirical formats as a mode of communications. At the same time, digital feminist activity can also be exhausted because dominant cultures and language have a significant role in selecting those who can be heard, included the scene in the movement. So according to feminist activist Faith Wilding, there is a tendency through among many cyber feminists to include techno-utopian expectations that the new media will offer women a fresh start to create new languages, programs, platforms, images, fluid identities, and multi-subjects definitions in a cyberscape. That is, in effect, women can record, redesign, and reprogram information technology to help change the feminine condition. The fourth wave of feminism is still in its nascent stage in India. Women are using digital tools to demand accountability from their governments, corporations, and leaders. In India, digital feminist movements largely rely on a social media platform. So if you talk about the today cyber feminism in today's time, that although it seems like in a apocalyptic future use of the internet, that cyber feminists are creating important perspective within the digital rights works, like that are they are key to creating more radical access and inclusion and implementation of teach tools that our movements desperately need. Here is the examples of cyber feminism. So first examples is Lahuka Gnan. It was the in 2017 the hashtag Lahuka Gnan hashtag took over on a Twitter on campaigning against the 12% tax on sanitary napkins, with the period tax being scrapped in 2018 as a result of the movement. And there was a lot of controversy in that debate. Second examples of the we all aware about this example movement that in 2012 in the aftermath of the death of the 23-year-old girl rape victim in Delhi, widespread protest broke out under the Nirbhaya movement, and the protest spread to social media as well. Hashtag like Delhi Braveheart were used by millions in support of justice for the victim, and this online rage coupled with the stress protest garnered global attention to compel an otherwise apathetic government to take a quick action. So third example of in 2017 this culminated in the hashtag why loiter hashtag trending on a Twitter is that about women posting pictures and stories of how they were reclaiming public sense, public spaces, creating the narrative of resisting male domination and patriarchy in the physical and virtual spaces. So it is also a well-known example of this cyber feminism that in 2018 the hashtag MeToo movement gained momentum in India, enabling women to share their stories of sexual harassment on a social media. It also led to activists successfully lobbying the governments to strengthen then sexual harassment of women at workplace. In the Act 2013, which previously had many weaknesses, that we have more victims from the our Bollywood actress and famous actress like Chetan Bhagat, Vikas Bahal, Alok Nath, Nana Patekar, and Kailash Kher. It seems that social media allows the marginalized voices the possibility of being heard in the public discourses. So another study of women's movements on social media by Sujatha Subramaniam, who interviewed a Dalit feminist activist noted in Kerala, the voice of subaltern groups are very prominent on social media, especially sexual minorities and Dalit groups. On social media, all of us are publishers. So another example of the in 2013, acid attack survivor Lakshmi Agrawal gathered 27,000 signatures through an online petition and stop acid sale to curb the sales of acid, and took the issue to the Supreme Court. And the campaign gained nationwide attention and allowed several other acid attacks for survivors to voice the support for the ban on acid sale. So in sum up, we can say that cyber feminism goes beyond previous feminist waves that convinced women as a homogeneous group whose interests could be represented by singular agenda to avoid reflecting the damaging universalism of old style feminism. It is essential that cyber feminism becomes more diverse, decentralized and democratic. Here is my references. Thank you.
Okay, so in your presentation, it was good. Huh? You prepared well. Some interesting points, contemporary also you brought. Okay. In citation, still there is some problem. Like, if you see, let me share the screen. You refer to Geeta Pandey, Delhi Nirbhaya rape death penalty. BBC site you have referred. So Pandey is the last name. So Pandey, comma Geeta. Then Shruti Jain. If you see the next one. So Jain, comma Shruti. Yes, last name, first name. The rising fourth wave. That is there. Okay. Then other works like. Your average is 88 percentage. That is good, above class average, so it is good. And all your work is complete, so no, there are no missing tasks, so that also is good there. And the test that you have taken, in the test you are here, you are on the side of left and authoritarian, slightly authoritarian. And on the left side, that you are standing there. In this is the political compass here, and you are slightly on the left authoritarian side. Okay. Okay, fine. So next presenter is now Riddhi. Yes.
Yes, hello everyone. Good morning, sir, and my all dear friends. Today, in our last presentation, cultural studies, let me share my screen. Is it visible? Okay. So, hello everyone again. My topic name is Why Are We So Scared of Robots and Artificial? And also, I include one point that aliens also. So, let's start. First one is key objectives. So, first we see that what exactly is robot? Then, why are we so scared of robots and aliens also? And third one is the three fears about robots. Then is there a danger robot or artificial is going to take over the world? This question and some example of movies. So what exactly is a robot? Whether you are excited about it or not, robots and artificial intelligence are an inevitable part of future that we are fast approaching. So according to Encyclopedia of Britannica, automatically operate machine that replace human effort, thought it may not resemble human being in appearance or perform function in a human-like manner. By extension, robotics is to engineering discipline dealing with the design, construction, and operation of robots. Then according to Merriam-Webster dictionary, a machine that resemble a living creature is to moving independently, and such a machine built to resemble a human being or animal in appearance and behavior. So my most important question that why are we so scared of robots? robots have become an integral part of the manufacturing industry, but they are also moving into other industries as well. So as they continue to become a larger part of our society, people are voicing growing fears about them, whether it's fear for their jobs, their lives, or something else entirely. It's all built on a lack of knowledge. We have all seen science fiction films about robots turning on their masters, and we have certainly heard that talk about how robots are coming to steal human jobs, but are they really so bad? So my answer is that the answer is no. So here we first see that some fears about robots, they simply don't hold up to the light. The first one is that they are not safe. First and foremost, you will hear about how robots are not safe. While it's true that fenced robot in manufacturing are behind that fence for a reason, that's not to say that their collaborative counterparts are dangerous as well. While nothing is completely safe, collaborative robots are in fact built using a standard set of guidelines known as the ISO. Here I'm putting also in the link. So today's standards combined with safety technology has resulted in a several excellence option for a safety with collaborative robots. So these are three standards that power and force limiting, speed and separation monitoring, hand guiding. So new safety technology continues to emerge as time goes on quickly, revealing that humans have no need to fear their safety around robots in the workplace, so long as they are well informed. Our second fear is that they will take our jobs. So throughout history, people have always feared technology because they were scared it would make their job obsolete. Car, the printing press, industrial technology, all of these things were met with fear in the past. So instead, technology creates new industries, new jobs, and more prosperity as a whole. So with robots, the same thing is happening today. People in manufacturing are afraid their jobs will be taken, but new jobs are already being created. Whether it's someone to program the robots or a human to work on more intricate tasks that the robot can't perform, new roles are emerging as robots increase production and lower costs. So there is nothing to fear because technology creates for more than it destroys when it's come to industries, jobs, and careers. So according to Bill Gates, in one interview, Bill Gates said that it is really bad if people overall have more fear about what innovation is going to do than they have enthusiasm. So Bill Gates, Microsoft founder Bill Gates said that seems to be taking the position that we have nothing to fear but fear itself. He has also voiced his opinion that people need to approach advancements in technology with enthusiasm, not outright fear. He seems to believe that if we plan accordingly, these fears in advance, humankind will have nothing to worry about. So these are some solutions also. And our third fear is that artificial intelligence is dangerous. So we have made some huge strides in regards to artificial intelligence, but we are a long way off from robots that are as smart or smarter than humans. People who think about decades in the future may have concern about the intelligence of robots being used against us, but they are not something we need to worry about now. So the current landscape of robotics put us squarely in control, and as a result, the idea of robots turning on us or becoming sentient is still in the realism of science fiction. So major technology features like Elon Musk, Stephen Hawking, and others are already thinking about how to properly harness artificial intelligence. Geoff Hinton, known as the godfather of deep learning, told the BBC that you can see things clearly for the next few years, but look beyond 10 years and we can't really see anything. It's just a hope. So instead, we should focus on the fact that today's artificial intelligence system can process information to vast or to complex for humans to grasp. There is nothing to fear from the growth of artificial intelligence as we are still in the infancy of the technology. So question is that, is there a danger robot or artificial intelligence is going to take over the world? So according to Jonah Bryson, she said that there is a lot of reality intelligent people who are not trying to take over the world. There are a broken idea that anything that is intelligent will have the same kind of ambition as we have. So she gave one example of cheetah, that the idea that just because humans are the smarter, anything that is intelligent will become a person is a broken. So that is like thinking any animal that become fast will turn into a cheetah. According to Janel Sen, she one TED Talk video, the danger of artificial is weird than you think. So she said that, so when we are working with artificial, it's up to us to avoid problems and avoiding thinking going to wrong. That may come down to the age-old problem of communication, where we as humans have to learn how to communicate with the artificial intelligence. We have to learn what artificial intelligence is capable of doing and what is not. And to understand that with its tiny little warm brain, artificial intelligence doesn't really understand what we are trying to ask it to do. So in other words, we have to be prepared to work with artificial intelligence that's not the super component. All knowing artificial intelligence of science fiction, we have to be prepared to work with an artificial intelligence that's the we actually have in the present day. And present day artificial intelligence is plenty weird enough. So we take some we take some movies from Bollywood that these are movies are old movies, and I also include the fear from aliens also. So this movie that Wahan ke log in 1967, and it's also translated in people from out there, this name. So in 1967, Hindi science fiction film directed by N.A. Ansari, and this movie story is like that, when Martians in this character of a movie that Martian invade the earth, they form an alliance with the gangster and set out to destroy the planet, and now it is up to the civilians to protect their home. Then second one, Kalai Arasi, translation in a Queen of Arts, this translation movie, and is a 1963 Indian Tamil language science fiction comedy film directed by A. Kasi Lingam, and it was the first Indian film to feature the concept of alien visiting Earth. So in this movie, I briefly tell about that Vani is a female protagonist in this movie, and she is kidnapped by the alien who need her to teach music and dance to their inhabitants. And Mohan, the male protagonist, or her lover, chances to upon the alien left behind on Earth and manage to make his way to the alien planets. So main concept is that we are not aware about this all these things, and then this type of a fear, we make it this like films. Then also example of some movies of robots and aliens, so Koi Mil Gaya in 2003, and then PK 2014, then Robot and Robot 2.0, these are the movies. So main question is that will robot will take over? So from Mary Shelley's Frankenstein to the Vetroxy's Matrix films, popular culture tells terrifying tales or robots turning against us. What makes us imagine this? Why do we retell story of robotic rebellion so often? So if robots are unpaid worker, would not have be rebel in their shoes? While we know robots are not people, on some level we cannot help assign them human traits, especially as they are doing more and more of our work. As they become more intelligent and more capable, we start wondering things like what if they become self-aware, and what if they dislike their working condition. So it's depend upon us that a robot may not injure a human beings or through inject inaction and allow a human beings to come to harm. A robot must obey order given it's by human beings, except where such a order would conflict with the first law. And a robot must protect its own existence as long as such a protection does not conflict with the first or second law. So this is a small movie, short film, and I want to present here that robots are not enemy or like devil, but it's become also our friends. Okay, so my most main concept is that why we are so scared and robots are bad or good. So we are seeing many movies like robot and old movies like that artificial intelligence is harmful to us. But science fiction, not science fact. We must remember that stories like iRobot, one movie, and the Terminator films are just that stories. Smarter robots might seem more dangerous, but intelligence is not simple sliding scale. So we are not afraid to robots and artificial intelligence, but it's helpful to us. Thank you so much. These are reference.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, well prepared and well presented. Good citations and other sources are also very well integrated in the things. Yeah. So today you are also getting full score in your PPT. And good arguments were also given. So that is also very important that you make some arguments that these are the questions, this is what they do, and you try to justify with the help of some other articles. Okay, and let us quickly have a look at your work in Google Classroom. Yes, so you got 90%, so it is good, above the class average of 85%, so that is a good performance. And any work is pending? This one work is pending. Thinking activity, wide Saragaso C. So one work is, only one is pending there, and the missing task there. And your test that you have taken, you are scoring somewhere towards the liberal and the left. That is where you are standing there. The red dot, I'm sharing that screen. Yeah, red dot is showing that where do you stand in this. Okay, fine. So next presenter will have to be a little bit quick. It is already 1 o'clock now. Yes, Niyati.
Yeah. I'm sharing your screen, Niyati.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. So we have last paper of cultural studies. My topic is five types of cultural studies. First of all, let's understand about culture. What is culture? Cultural studies is an innovative interdisciplinary field of research and teaching, and investigates the ways in which culture creates and transforms individual experience, everyday life, social relations, and power. Culture means it is the related to the particular society and its idea, costume, and art. Culture is the word which is impossible to describe in the world. Next. Culture is the consist of activities such as the art and philosophy which are considered to be important for the development of the civilization and people's mind, even particular society or civilizations, especially considering the relation to its beliefs, way of life or art. Culture is the word, it's impossible to elaborate in the one word. Next. Culture is derived from Latin word cultura, to honor and protect. Culture is a symbolic communication. Culture is the system of knowledge shared by a relatively large group of people. It is the learned behavior of society and of society or a subgroup. Next. Cultural studies, what is cultural studies? It is the science of understanding modern society with an emphasis on politics and power. Cultural studies is an umbrella term used to look at a number of different subjects. Categories studied include media studies, including film, journalism, sociology, industrial culture, globalization, and social theory. The definition of cultural study can sometimes be misunderstood, misconstruct. It is not simply the study of different cultures, but uses many other studies to analyze different cultures, such as philosophy, theology, literature, etc. Next. Cultural studies is not a tightly coherent, unified movement with a fixed agenda, but a loosely coherent group of tendencies, issues, and questions. Cultural studies includes Marxism, post-structuralism, post-modernism, popular culture, post-colonial studies, socialism, feminism, gender study, film theory, and modernism. Next. Cultural studies is composed of elements of Marxism, post-structuralism, film theory, urban studies, public policy, popular culture studies, and post-colonial studies. This field that concentrates on social and cultural forces, the either create community or cause division of alienation. There is a little doubt that concept of culture as a way of life initially provided the key authorizing concept of cultural studies as a distinctive intellectual and political practice. Next. Cultural studies research is often focused on how a particular phenomenon relates matters of ideology, nationality, ethnicity, social class, and gender. Since culture is now considered as the source of art and literature, cultural criticism has gained ground, and therefore Raymond Williams' term cultural materialism, Stephen Greenblatt's cultural poetics, and Bakhtin's term cultural prosaic have become significant in the field of cultural studies and cultural criticism. Next. It looks at popular culture and everyday life, which had hitherto been dismissed as inferior and unworthy of academic study. Cultural studies approaches transcend the confines of a particular discipline, such as literary criticism, history, and are politically engaged. Reject the distinction between high and low, art or elite, and popular culture. And fourth is analyze not only the cultural works but also the means of production. Next. The cultural practice of giving dolls to girls can be read within the patriarchal discourse of femininity, that girls are weaker and delicate and need to be given soft things, and that grooming, care, etc. Feminine duties which dolls will help them to learn. This discourse of femininity is itself related to the discourse of masculinity and the larger context of power relations in cultural. Identity for culture studies is constituted through experience which involves representations the conception of science, the making of meaning from science, and the knowledge of meaning. Next. Types of cultural studies. British cultural materialism is first. Second is new historicism, then American multiculturalism, postmodernism and popular culture, and last is postcolonial studies. Next. British cultural materialism. Cultural study is referred to as cultural materialism in Britain. Matthew Arnold sought to redefine the givens of British culture. Edward Burnett Taylor's pioneering anthropology study primitive culture. Culture or civilization taken in its widest anthropographic sense is a complex whole which includes knowledge, beliefs, art, morals, laws, custom, and any other capabilities and habits acquired by man as a member of society. Cultural materialism began in earnest in the 1950s with the work of F.R. Lewis, heavily influenced by Matthew Arnold's analysis of bourgeois culture. Cultural materialism also turned to the more humanistic and even spiritual insight of the great student of Rabelais and Dostoevsky, Russian formalist Bakhtin, especially his amplification of the dialogic form of meaning within narrative and class struggle. Next. Cultural materialism in modern Britain, two trajectories for cultural development, one led back to the past and the feudal hierarchies that ordered community in the past. Here, cultural acted in its scared function as a preserve to the past. The order trajectory led toward a future socialist utopia that would annul the distinction between labor and leisure classes. Next. There are no masses. There are only ways of seeing people as masses, quoted by Williams. Next. New historicism is a school of literary theory first developed in 1980. The term new historicism was coined by American critic Stephen Greenberg. New historicism is a literary theory based on the idea that literature should be studied and interpreted within the context of both the history of the author and the history of the critic. A number of historicists claim that these cultural and ideological representations in text serve mainly to reproduce. A new historicist looks at literature in a wider historical context, examining both how the writer's times affected the work and how the work reflects the writer's time, in turn recognizing the current cultural context colored then critics' conclusions. New historicism is that it is method based on the parallel reading of literary and non-literary text, usually of the same historical period. Next. The text is historical and historitextual. These are stated by Michael Warner. And history is always historicized. New historicism has made its biggest mark on literary studies of the Renaissance and Romantic periods and has received motions of literature as privileged apolitical and writing. Next. Then comes American multiculturalism. Multiculturalism. Multiculture is involving or relating to several ethnic groups or cultural groups within a society. It includes people who have many different beliefs and customs. It could be designed for cultures or different races. As a philosophy, multiculturalism began as part of the pragmatism movement at the end of the 19th century in Europe and the United States. American multiculturalism came into existence in 1964 with the passing Civil Rights Act. In literary field, America exists with different culture which belongs to different idea about literature. Cultural studies regarding America with other culture and then their multi-production of literary forms also. Cultural studies regards four writers from a different culture whose concern with American literary field. Next. Every American should understand Mexico from the point of view of the observer of the conquest of the history before the conquest. In 1972, Harvard University study by the geneticist Richard Leontine found the most genetic difference were within racial group, not between them. In the new country, if interracial trends continue, Americans will be puzzled by race distinctions from the past, since children of multiracial black backgrounds may be the norm rather than the exceptions. Next. Here is four types of American writers. Next. Postmodernism and popular culture. The term postmodernism first entered the philosophical lexicon in 1979 with the publication of The Postmodern Condition by Jean-Francis Lyotard. It's a reaction against the philosophical assumptions, values and intellectual worldview of the modern period of Western history. Postmodernism questions everything rationalist European philosophy held to be true. Next. Popular culture is the entirely of ideas, perspective, attitudes, images and other phenomena that are within the mainstream of a given culture. Especially Western culture, the early to mid 20th century, and the emerging global mainstream of the late 20th century, early 21st century. Once we define the term, and then it becomes very easy to understand. These terms are it is also known as pop culture. So the term popular culture was coined in the 19th century or earlier. Next. Next, in literary field, America exists with different culture which belongs to different idea about literature. Cultural studies regarding America.
Yes, you can continue.
In literary field, America exists with different culture which belongs to different idea about literature. Cultural studies regarding America with other culture and then their multi-production of literary forms also. Cultural studies regards four writers from different culture whose concern with American literary field.
There is a network problem here, so your screen might not be shared, but you can continue and complete your presentation. Is it done? Is it over? Your presentation is over? Yes, Niyati, is your presentation over?
No, sir. Last two slides are remaining.
So if you have anything as a notebook from where you prepared, then you can complete from your handouts also, because here there is no internet, network failure. We were appreciating in the beginning that for 4 days there is no internet failure.
and now we had a failure there.
I covered the points which I wrote in notebook.
So you can conclude. You can conclude your. Okay, so to overview your there now get. Got the connection? Okay. I think we you just put the mic off. Now this conclusion part only was remaining. Okay, so in your presentation, that was fine. Your overall percentage is 77.98 in Google Classroom. Let me connect from my laptop here. Yeah. Now we have internet connection here. Okay, so let me connect from this and share the screen. So, okay, 77. So that is quite below 85. That is class average. So your performance in scoring is lower than the class average. But you have done all the tasks. That is good. So that reflects your punctuality and sincerity, that all the works are submitted in due time. Yes. Okay, fine. And the test that is taken, also you are at the center, almost at the center, in the row that is just on the side of left authoritarian side, that is the political compass that speaks there. Okay, fine. So we can take the next presenter. Online presenter is there. Next is Nandita. Yeah, your, but it is connected, not connected. So we can take Nandita right now. Once we will get internet here, then we will take Nidhi's turn. Yes, Nandita, are you ready?
Sir, I need to connect one. Just 2 minutes.
Yeah, okay, yeah, okay. Put here the microphone. Once you start, then you can.
Is it visible properly?
Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Today is the last day of our presentation. I am presenting from the paper Cultural Studies. My topic is Cultural Studies and its different aspects. First of all, we have look upon the definition of what is Cultural Studies. I had made the recent consent what we are suffering from and what the problems is we are facing from, which is over the corona pandemic time. In the elaboration of the definition, we can have the justice with cultural studies that it is a field of theoretically, politically, and empirically engaged cultural analysis that concentrates upon the political dynamics of contemporary culture. So here the definition of cultural studies is emerging as the concentrates over political dimensions, because cultural studies is somewhere more connected to political dynamism, as we have the cult that is culture in the cultural studies. Culture is somehow definitely prolonging the lifestyle of the people. Culture also includes our nationalism, day-to-day life, religion, perspective to deal with consequences. So here the culture studies researchers generally investigates that how cultural practice relate to wider systems of power associated with or operating through the social phenomena such as ideology, class, structure, nationalism, formations, and sexual orientations. There is also to another concept, which is gender and generation. So here gender and generation plays biggest role in the cultural studies, as we talked earlier that it is connected to political devices or political circumstances, as gender and generation both are given same perspective as of the cultural studies. Another thing is cultural studies views cultures not as fixed boundaries, but it views it as stable and discrete entities rather than constantly interactions and changing sets of practice and processes. The another thing is globalization. As we have taken the survey yesterday, we get to know some important points which I need to consider here, and that is that globalization should serve as humanity and not as national corporate. So we can strongly agree with this thing that globalization must serve the humanity. It should not be that much. It should not be that much of commercial, which is not profiting the people, or which is we can say that in recent decades, as capitalism has spread throughout the world via contemporary forms of globalization, cultural studies has generated important analysis of local sites and practices of negotiation with and resistance to Western hegemony. Here, Western hegemony is something which is capable of spreading the capitalism, which is a contemporary form of cultural studies, because it is based on the national term, which is globalization. Globalization is globally invented with liberalization also. So this concept is wide more appreciation with the end of cultural studies. The another concept which is worldwide accepted is the cultural consumptions. Now here the question arises that how cultural consumption can be globally manifested. So the cultural studies must grapple with the fact that we now live in an era where throughout the capitalist world, or the overriding aim of government and economic policy is to maintain consumer spending levels. So here the another important aspects are that people are ultimately divided more by class than by nationality. So this term of consumption of culturalism in humanity on in person's individual ability is the another aspect to see how humans are consuming the culture. It is not only developed on some senses which is corporated by human mind, but it is also important that how people are consuming the culture over their mind, or differentiate between how they are more relevant to class or they are more relevant to their nationality as well. The another concept of cultural studies is the concept of text. Here, if we when we hear in the first instant the word text, we will get a formation of thing that there are some books or something which can be read by our eyes. But here the concept of text in cultural studies is somewhat different, because it designates the television program, it designates films, photographs, and fashion material styles also. So these things can also be concluded as text, not only the books but also all these visual things which we can experience in our day-to-day life. So cultural studies drawn upon developing the semiotics, and so far the text of cultural studies comprises all the meaningful artifacts of culture. So these are the meaningful artifacts of culture, that culture is having all these things which we are using in our routine life. The most of these things are connected to self-implementation of the people who are living in the society. And another thing is that cultural studies approaches the site and spaces of everyday life, such as pubs, living rooms, gardens, beach, and etc. All these things can be considered as text. First, when we made the interpretation of text, this we cannot imagine that living rooms or beach or garden or television programs can also be a term of text. But when we get deep into the cultural studies, we will understand how these things can also be considered as text, and why we are considering it as an important aspect of cultural studies. The another concern for cultural studies is the focus and the question that what is cultural studies major? Here the major term is the opposition of minor to, but I had concluded it by major because it is a wide strata of definition which cultural study plays in the life of the people. So cultural studies is an interdisciplinary major that examines the issue of race, ethnicity, class, culture, and drawing on the social culture and literary theories. This major introduces methods of interpretation for the analysis of cultural objects in their social content. So here social content is something which is directly interpreted by interdisciplinary things. So interdisciplinary things is a wide concept which can be the basis of the issues like race, gender discriminations, class and nationality. There must be the class conflict, there must be the cultural conflict here. So cultural studies can also be wider studied in all this sense. All this sense may play the negative aspect in our lives, but as we want to make it more wider, or as we want to more get focus on it, then the cultural studies may have these type of disciplinaries which can conclude the culture by itself. Now the another thing is the focus. Here the cultural study is focusing upon what? So the cultural studies is focusing, rather than concentrating exclusively on the group of elite texts that make up so-called high culture. So here high culture is something which is made more and more higher by the richer classes, not by putting down their culture or their enthusiastic behavior in the corporate world. So cultural studies takes as it focus the whole complex of changing beliefs, ideas, feelings and values, which symbolizes that define a community, organization and sense of itself. So cultural studies main focus is not on the high culture, but to signify the main things which cannot be visible by mankind, which is beliefs, which is ideas, which is values and which is feelings, which can be just make assumption of all those things. We cannot make it fully over the distinct place of cultural studies. Another thing is the characteristics over which cultural studies is depending upon. So here are the main five characteristics over which cultural studies can make it based upon. The first must be the object of the cultural studies is to understand culture in all its complex forms. Means cultural studies is that much of a diverse subject because it concludes everything. It concludes the nature's feeling. It is having the humanity. It is considering the nationality, the globalization, the focus on culture. And if we get a sense of it, that culture is also different and cultural studies is also different. So the studies of the main orientation of culture, we can conclude it as the cultural studies, and analyzing the social and political content in which culture manifests itself. So cultural studies main objective is to understand the complexity of culture, that what we are experiencing in day-to-day life, and what the things which are getting more and more complex in our form. The another thing is that cultural study is a site of political criticism. Now as I earlier discussed, that cultural studies is more way forward connected to political politics, because it has some more complex complexities. We can have some example here also, that it is not only it would that cultural studies scholar studies an object, but they may also connect this study to a larger political subject. Means that cultural studies can be a larger political subject by manifesting its own complexities. So scholars does not focus on a single or particular object, but it is way much wider than what we are thinking of. The another important characteristics of cultural study is that it attempts to expose and reconcil constructed divisions of knowledge that supports to be grounded in nature. So anything which is grounded to nature means anything which is very easy, which is colloquial to understand, and which is very normalizing by the people, can be considered as an exposure of cultural studies. Another thing is that cultural studies has a commitment to an ethical evaluation of modern society. So we are living in a modern society, so it is very obvious that cultural study has its more impact on the modern society. And the last but not the least, the final characteristic of cultural study aims at cultural studies could not be examine cultural practices and their reaction to power the following critical theory. Means there are many critical theories by scholars who are mainly not focusing on the object, but focusing on the downward thing which are experiencing by normal people. Normal people in the sense, the people who are concluding themselves as middle class or lower middle class people, because cultural studies is a study of whole manifestation of humanity. So in humanity, rich, poor, every single person can be included. So cultural studies main importance is to give the conclusion over not only a singular form of participation, but participation of every single person in every single day of their lifestyle. So here are my citations which I took references. Thank you. Hope you all like it.
Okay, so content wise it was okay, but still it seems that understanding of many of the points are still lacking in cultural studies. So it is full of sound and fury, but whether it signifies anything or not, that still remains a question. Okay, fine. I'm sharing a screen to display the work. So your overall percentage is 73. Our class average is 85, so it is quite below the class average. So in all the performances, you have performed below the class average, so that you can take care that next time you are up to the mark or above class average. And so far as the work is concerned, I think you have completed most of the work. One task is missing. It is online test on Midnight's Children. Okay, only one task is missing. So I hope that by today or tomorrow you will complete this work. Okay, so it seems you have covered up from yesterday. You have completed most of your tasks overnight. Okay? And your test is concerned. Your test, you are on the central line so far as authoritarian and libertarian is concerned, quite in the center, and slightly left oriented. In left and right, you are on the left side, and authoritarian, libertarian, neither authoritarian nor libertarian. That is the point that you are getting in this particular test. we are seeing that most of you are near the center round. And then you can say that why that happens. That also we will try to see that how when we'll see more such certificates that are generated. Okay, fine. So the next presenter now is Nidhi.
Hello everyone. Good afternoon to all of you. Shall I start, sir?
Yes.
So I'm presenting my screen. I hope it is visible. Is it? Okay, just now visible. Okay. So from the 2 days, we are seeing some of the example of eco-criticism. Like Lata also take the eco-criticism and connected with post-colonialism, the post-colonial study. Yesterday also, Aditi made a presentation on eco-criticism. So I was thinking that we are moving toward the our generation in the 21st century, how eco-criticism play a very vital role in how we are destroying and destroyed at the nature. But suddenly, how this eco-criticism was started in our English literature. So I took this topic for representing. So I also, if we are looking our Asian type, like a Sanskrit literature, yes, definitely I'm going to talk about eco-criticism in Indian English literature, but I would like to give a brief introduction about the eco-criticism in our Sanskrit literature. So how can we forget our great epic poet Kalidas? So Kalidas also in his work Meghdootam discussed this idea of eco-criticism. So it is very a very new term. It's come from our Asian time. So if we want to present on eco-criticism, we have so many topics. We have a wide and huge material for eco-criticism, and I'm trying a little bit to represent a more idea about the Indian eco-criticism in Indian writing in English. So and yes, especially in our Gujarati literature also talk so many authors talk about it, that idea of eco-criticism. We also have seen in our classroom that how eco-criticism, post-colonial effect on eco-criticism, then post-colonialism, even the globalization. Okay, sir. So we are seeing that. So now let's jump toward our main presentation. So what is the eco-criticism? So eco-criticism was a term coined in the late 1970s by the combining criticism with a shortened from the ecology. So I don't want to read a whole, and this is the definition of eco-criticism. Basically, eco-criticism is made by the two words, eco and criticism. Eco means this earth, this environment, this nature, and criticism means study. So eco-criticism is about the study of nature, study of the earth, study of thing which is around us. So eco-criticism asks questions such as in a literature that how is nature represented in the novel, poem, or play? What role does the physical and geographical setting play in the structure of the novel? How do our metaphor of the land influence the way we treat it? And how is science in the form of a genetic and engineering, technological or reproduction and sexuality open the critical structure? The term of the effect of the science upon the land. So these are observations I have taken from these articles from the Membrul. So now let's jump toward the example, like Indian English author how they pick the eco-criticism in their work. So first I would like to give the idea of the Ruskin Bond. So there, according to Dr. Cynthia, that there has always been a close relationship between nature and literature all over the world. So Bond, a true artist, like aesthetic scenes, a vision of a paradise in the sunlight and a green of the earth, in the beauty of the human face and the wealth of a human life, even in a object that are apparently insightful, and nature, life, sense, forms, love, and the secret of the divine power, are therefore the keyword of his credo as a writer. So in the work of Ruskin Bond, we found that the depiction of eco, or we can say nature, is very quite a positive way. So for example, in his work, in the Night Plan of Deoli, it is taken by his work, "Our trees still grow in Dehra." So when it is a short story, when we read the short story written by him, we found that there is the most of the depiction of Dehradun and Mussoorie. And yes, they describe the scene of Dehradun and Mussoorie, and almost inevitably from the setting of his work, and reflect in his art. So they depict a very good and we can say a positive think of nature. So according to Kumari Shikha, when history is examined, the another example is of Raja Rao. So how Raja Rao depict eco-criticism in his work. So Raja Rao is the prominent writer of the Indian English novel. His depiction of the South Indian village, culture, and environmental setting is a true depiction of the relationship between man and nature. The another is the R.K. Narayan. R.K. Narayan wrote in the same decade and have given a life to the place Malgudi. Or it can be said that he has developed a place as a character which can be seen in almost all his prose fiction bearing the same features. So another writer is the Bengali writer Kamala Markande. Kamala Markande, in her novel Nectar in a Sieve and the Flood, which is taken from her novel, the Nectar in Sieve has a very well description of the control of nature over the human being. So in his work, she wanted to depict there is like a wild animal. Nature is like a wild animal that you have trained to work for you. So first we have seen that Bond, how Bond depicts the nature in his work, then Raja Rao, then R.K. Narayan, and now slowly and steadily we move toward the depiction of eco-criticism, where we are depicting really that we are human being destroying the nature. And and we are believing that nature is for our joy, nature is for our peace. So it is not true. Nature doing a thing as according their cycle, and human being is not there is no doubt that human being is connected with nature, but nature and human being is two different things. So we have to mind it. So the another prominent writer is the Anita Desai. So also Anita Desai, she is trying to close this gap between the post-colonialism and this eco-criticism. So nature, which include the animal, plants, birds, has a strong presence in almost all her works, and known in the Indian English fiction for unsharing in the psychological novel. And Desai uses the external landscape to portray the interior state of mind. And here I putting one example that her example, his work Cry the Peacock. And the next example is the Rachel Zima's theory of eco-criticism might have raised the eyebrow of many writers, but it indeed has led to inclusion of many novels under his branch. And she has tried to close the gap between the post-colonialism and eco-criticism by analyzing the texts that depict on the range of the engagement with the environment and that complication, and extend the notion of a place and connections. So in this slide and next two slides, I'm going to discuss some of the important work by Arundhati Roy and Ghosh. So Arundhati, The God of Small Things by Arundhati Roy, in this work, she discusses the same eco-critical idea that how we are destroying the nature. And Arundhati Roy's The God of a Small Thing is a depiction of exploitation of nature by people for the sake of progress and modernization, which is a privileging topic of the novel. So in this novel, we can say that for the sake of globalization, we are harming eco-criticism. So this is the main idea of the novel, and the creator here has given her sharp familiarity with the present squeezing nature issue. And the writer raises her voice for the earth, which is presently under an incredible risk of a contaminations right now uncovered the enormous data basement of the nature as well as the considered the explanation for its dehumanization. This observation done by the Deepthi Chopra in his in her article. So now let's jump toward the how Arcanine. I mentioned in Arcanine, but that was very briefly. So here I put a full slide how Arcanine's work discuss this idea of eco-criticism. So Sarkar observed in his article that Arcanine is the man eater. It is the character from the Malgudis. Is there any proof? To bring out the eco, it is the fertile ground. So in his work, Malgudi, Arcanine depicts that how man eater. Okay, so is it visible? Screen is visible? Okay. Yes, the man-eater of the Malgudi is the fertile ground of the applying the eco-criticism. To bring out the eco-critic connection of connotation of this novel, it must be considered as an allegory, and the symbolical indication must be extended up to the issue of environmental disaster. The focal point of this novel is the massive killing of animal and the ruthless process of a shuffling. The activities of the taxidermy details here can be extended to show the larger scale of environmental disruption. So how Arcanine, by the character of man-eater, discussed this idea of eco-criticism. So we are harming the animals, we are harming the nature. So it is one kind of allegory which represent that we are destroying or we are making a disaster in environment. Now Amitav Ghosh's novel. So this observation is done by the Sandhya in his article that Ghosh's novel are not only the substantial body of a work which deal with the historical issue and social issue, but also the author has dealt with the environmental issue. So in his one interview, Amitav Ghosh mentioned that I write the book that I want to read about the things that interest me. I am curious about the environment, about history, words and language. The idea of writing a book where you learn those things out, the five seems and boring because these are the textual make life interesting. So it is the idea of Amitav Ghosh that Amitav Ghosh does not only describe these historical facts and historical issue, but also put a light on the environmental street. Camera is not working, sir. Right.
On, sir. On. Okay.
Now, okay. Yeah. Yes, sir. Now is it? It is with it? Okay. So. A screen is visible? Slide, okay. So now next example is The Hungry Tide. This is a very fascinating and interesting work that discusses the idea of eco-criticism by Amitav Ghosh. So Ghosh's masterpiece, The Hungry Tide, is considered the first work in the Indian English fiction who boldly raised the ecological issue first time in the Indian and try his best to protect the environment. He depicts the association between the people and the fauna and flora and the physical environment, and in doing so, this work depicts both the calamity and the duplicity that were inherent in the conservation effort in the Sundarbans. In the novel of The Hungry Tide, the novelist reveals the tension between human beings within the same community and their ties with the natural environment. So I'm trying to depict in a three types that first I'm taking the example of Ruskin Bond, then another example of the Dark and Narayan and Amitav Ghosh, and some more famous some famous authors. And now I would like to give the how Indian English writing in a poetry try to So how Indian in a poetry we are trying to depict that eco-criticism. So firstly, I would like to give the example of Torudat. So this observation is done by the Neutha in his article that Torudat is one of the famous Indo-Anglican poet. By birth, she is an Indian, and later she went to France and next to England, and finally she returned to England and learned Sanskrit. Through she is a converted Christian, and she wrote a number of poems on Indian mythical stories. Most of her poems have an Indian theme and Indian background, but this poem, Lotus, is a part of her natural poem. It is a poem of a royal beauty and fixed significance. So Lotus is a lyric which tells the legendary tale of how this flower, the lotus, came into the existence. So ecological overtone in a river by the Krishna Swami Ramanujam. So in this poem, river, the narrator talk the river Vaikai flowing through the ancient city of Madurai in the state of Tamil Nadu in India. And the poet A.K. Ramanujam brings out of the truth about the river being a summer and reminiscent about the flood and destruction caused by it. And the river is given spiritual significance and considered holy in the past. And in present, Madurai in the poem has been sketched by the narrator, who visit to see the culture, but to him it is a state of a dissolution. And he observed that the poet, past and present, only speak of the river during the rain and floods, whereas Ramanujam investigate the relation between the human and river in the everyday world. It show how the river prays to have a originate from the that origins from the Ganga, and has today lost all its beauty and has become a symbol of environmental and cultural degradation. The poet's understanding of environmental is clearly noted in this poem. So we are trying to depict. So we are trying to depict nature as a very positive way. We are not mentioning that issue connected with nature. We are destroying nature. We are just portraying nature for our own sake, for our beauty. But later on, we are understanding that we are destroying the beauty of nature, and that theme with that theme we are started to writing a particular works. So as I earlier told you that I tried to depict in a three way. First in how prose writing, then fiction writing, and now in a poetry writing. So and these are some of the example of poems which depict this idea of eco-criticism. But this poem is very, we can say, very not so much written in this century. It's written so long. So slowly and steadily, when we read some particular poem, we get the idea that how in a work, in a literature, in an Indian English writer, we are describing this idea of eco-criticism. So it is a short understanding of me, and I want to present here about how we are depicting this eco-critical idea in our old English literature. And you can say when we are started to write that English words. Yes, there is no doubt that we are moving toward so many further things now, the ecology, eco-criticism, we are harming, we are destroying, post-colonial theory with this idea. but it's a depict that we are starting like this and we are moving toward like that. So these are my citation, and thank you.
Okay, so you use the word taxidermy, yeah, in one of the slides, taxidermy. Yeah? So what is that? Are you aware about that? In Arcanarayan slide, I think it was. Taxidermy. Okay, by the time, let me see the other things. That was this slide. Yes, yeah. Okay, so you got 94.7. So that is a good performance, quite above the class average. So that is good. And any tasks are incomplete? No, it seems you have completed all the tasks also. Okay, so that is good performance in Google Classroom. Coming to the test, so you are okay, slightly down towards left and libertarian. There you are positioning, so just above Nelson Mandela and below Bernie Sanders. You are seeing your red dot here. Okay, fine. So taxidermy is you might have seen stuffing of dead animals. If you see museums and other place, so the dead animals are stuffed, so the skin and other things are there. That process is called as taxidermy. Ian Martel also has written a novel with this. Taxidermy is a character. Dermist is a character in that. Okay, fine. Next presenter. Now two presenters are remaining. So very quickly, we hope we'll be able to complete. Don't make it very long.
Hello, everyone. So my today's this is the last day of presentation, and we are making presentation on cultural studies, and my today's topic is Gayatri Spivak and Subaltern, and for that I would like to present my screen. Is it visible properly?
Now it is.
Okay. So this is the basic information about myself, and my topic is Gayatri Spivak and the subaltern theory. So first, I would like to give information about Gayatri Spivak. So Gayatri Spivak is an Indian scholar, literary theorist, and feminist critic. She is also a university professor at Columbia University, and she is founding member of the Establishment's Institute for Comparative Literature and Society. And she is considered as one of the most influential post-colonial intellectuals. Gayatri Spivak is best known for his essay, Can the Subaltern Speak? This is also his most controversial essay. And her translation of and introduction to Jacques Derrida's De la Grammatologie is also well known. and she was awarded the 2012 Kyoto Prize in Arts and Philosophy for being a critical theorist and educator speaking for the humanities against intellectual colonization in relation to the globalized world. And in 2013, she received the Padma Bhushan, the third highest civilian award given by the Republic of India. And she also utilized the method and approaches from Marxism, feminism, and deconstruction that is also seen in his works also. About Spivak, about Gayatri Spivak, Landy observed that there is no doubt that Gayatri Spivak is one of the most remarkable and outstanding theorists in the post-colonial theory. Along with Said and Pabha, she is a prominent pillar of the so-called the post-colonial trilogy. And additionally, Spivak is one of the foremost feminist critics who have attained the an international fame and eminence. And Spivak writing and field and interest are diverse, including her feminist perspective on deconstruction, her critique of imperialism and colonial discourse, her engagement with the Marxist critique of capital and the international division of labor, and her critique of race is relation to nationality, ethnicity, and immigrant groups. So in this article, Landy described that Gayatri Spivak is a most important figure of the post-colonial theory, and she is also an important pillar of post-colonial trilogy because her contribution to the post-colonial literature and the theory of subaltern. The next we see is that what is subaltern? If we want to talk about subaltern theory, we have to understand the term, what is subaltern. So subaltern is a subordinate position in terms of class, gender, race, and culture. And subaltern people are those people who are voiceless people and written out of the historical record and ignored because their activities do not count for culture and structure. Because of their, they are in minority, they are not counted as the culture and structure. So most of their activities and their works and all these things are not well known for other people because they wrote less about and they are voiceless people. And according to Spivak, people who belong to third world countries is considered as a subaltern, and it is impossible for them to speak up as they are divided by gender, class, caste, religion, and other narratives. And because of these all things, they are not stand up in unity. And this is the cause that they cannot speak, and their voice is not coming to the all people and in the global world. The subaltern is a term that subaltern term is borrowed from the Italian Marxist Antonio Gramsci's, and it is signified the oppressed class. And consequently, Spivak chooses to adopt the notion of the subaltern essentially because it is truly situational. It is not that it is truly situational. And subaltern began as a description of a certain rank in the military. The word was used under conspiracy by Gramsci. He called Marxism and monism, and was obligated to call the proletarian a subaltern. And that word used under duress has been transformed into the description of evaluating that does not fall under strict class analysis. And This is so because it has no theoretical rigor. In this article, Spivak said that about this term, that it is, the term is situational, and Gramsci uses this term as monism, and the obligation to call the proletarian as a subaltern. In next article, Spivak also argued about that this controversial statement that a subaltern cannot speak for himself or herself. Why it is happened? Because the very structure of colonial power, and we have to note here that it is used in the context of colonialism, and that colonial power prevent the speaking, and that is why they cannot speak for himself or herself. Next, we see that Ashcroft explained about subaltern, that according to him, what is a subaltern? So he said that, first of all, I would like to start with a general definition of the concept subaltern and its origin. Subaltern is a concept first used and coined by Antonio Gramsci, and to refer to those groups who are subject to the hegemony of the dominant classes, the people who are dominated by the people that upper the classes who are in power, they are called subalterns. And about subaltern, Coronel also explained that in her influential article, "Can the Subaltern Speak?" Spivak problematizes the production and retrieval of subaltern speech in the light of its dependence on controlling and dominant discursive practices, which define the modalities of expression of the subaltern subjects and construct the position from which they speak or are held. So about the essay of Gayatri Spivak, "Can Subaltern Speak?" Coronel explained that it is the term that problematizes the binary oppositions that coming in the society, that some group of people are dependent on another people, and they have to be dependent because the dominant group have a power to control them, and because of that they are not able to speak and to resistance for themselves. And in this article, we see that Spivak challenges the widespread thesis that the intellectual or post-colonial historian can recover the voice and consciousness of the subaltern. This is also the controversial point in the essay that Spivak was written in "Can the Subaltern Speak?" And he said that unlike Spivak, there has been no major revolution in modern history without intellectual, and conversely, there has been no major counter revolutionary movement without intellectuals. And intellectuals have been the fathers. Another of the movement, and others of the movements, and of course sons and daughters, even nephews and nieces. This is observation of said with the reference of the essay of Gayatri Spivak. And if we look at the subaltern theory in India, we see that in the 1980s, the enterprising historians started subaltern studies as a project to reclaim and rewrite Indian historiography from the subaltern perspective. As all the literature are now reread with the different perspective, so in this context, all the texts are reread and rewrite with the concept of subaltern theory and its perspective. So we can see that how the subaltern people are suffering and their situation of in that particular work or in a literary text. Further, we see Ranjit Guha took up the task to probe into the present moment of the past, which according to him were showcased as something monumental and outstanding by historians. And the theme that emerges across the early work undertaken by Subaltern Studies Group is the relation between the marginalized classes and the anti-colonial movement of the 20th century. That power relationship is an important point to be not in the subaltern theory, that some of the people are marginalized in their relationship, and some become the dominant at their level. So further, there is the observation of Biswas in the perspective of subaltern studies and the focus of subaltern studies. So he said that Guha believed that the politics of the subaltern did not constitute an autonomous domain, for it neither originated from elite politics nor did its existence depend on the latter. And the main focus of that subaltern studies is become the subordination, and in the context of subordination, the subaltern studies can be studied in the literature. Now I would like to explain the subaltern. I would like to explain that social formation with the subalterns that Gayatri Spivak has given in his essay also. So if we take example of class, the working class become the subaltern, and capitalist persons and that that industrialization and that person who have a power, they become dominant and they control the subalterns. So in capitalist bourgeois, we see that all these person are controlling working class people in the capitalism. And in the example of empire, the social formation of empire, we see natives are the subalterns. If we look at the example of Friday in 4, we see that he is the native people, and he was dominated by the Crusoe and Susan Barton, because they are the civilized person, and they were controlling Friday. Because Friday was native, and he is the person who get chances to be free from that or boundaries. But as a subaltern, he is not even trying to free from that all binaries and all these boundaries. As Gayatri Spivak talked about Bhuvaneshwari in his essay Can Subaltern Speak, she committed suicide not because of other things, but she don't wanted to participate in that association that he is signed for, but other people think that the other reasons are there for her suicide, but there was not the case. And if we look at the social formation of patriarchy, we feel it in our everyday life also, that women are from the childhood, the women are taught that you have to be a daughter, mother, sister, or wife, and that all womanhood things are taught to them as that dependent on the men or in the form of husband or brother or father. So that gender perspective is become the interesting topic in the study of subaltern. And if we look at the social formation of nation, some ethnic minorities and caste are become subaltern, and the majority people control them because they are in the majority, and they can on the name of nationalism, they can control them and suppress them with the name of nationalism. So in this way we connect of social formation with the subalterns. And these are my citations, and thank you.
Okay, so it's getting very lengthy, to the point. Try to make the presentations and same thing is repeated. You are referring to 2-3 articles that they are all saying the same thing about subaltern and about Gayatri Spivak. So why that all repetition is required? You make a trajectory that you move on in your things. So it becomes very dull and boring. People start yawning and you keep on reading everything. Okay, so let us see your work in Google Classroom. Okay, so you are scoring 92%, that is good. So that is above the class average. And so the performance is good, overall performance. And is there any incomplete tasks? Okay, it seems there are no incomplete tasks. So everything is regularly submitted and with good score also, you have done throughout the semester. Your this test that we are doing, political compass for the cultural studies, you are left and slightly towards libertarian. Yeah? So that is where you are standing in this test also. Okay, fine. So the last presenter now for this slot is Kishan. And don't take a very long time. Don't read everything. Very briefly summarize the things. It's already 2:15 now. Okay, so you have to take this group photo in between also. So to slightly make this up.
So hello everyone. Good afternoon. Today I'm going to present cultural studies paper. So my topic is Chetan Bhagat and his market. So let's start. First of all, I am share my screen. I hope my screen is visible. So first of all, I'm giving an introduction of Chetan Bhagat. So Chetan Bhagat was an Indian author and a columnist. He was included in Time magazine list of world's 100 most influential people in 2010. So here some his work. In his work also become some movie. So his first work, five of Chetan Bhagat's novel have been adapted into Bollywood films like Hello in 2008, Batch on One Night Sales Call Center, Three Idiots in 2009, in Batch on 5.someone, Kaipo Che in 2030, Batch on the Three Mistakes of My Life, and Two State in 2040, Batch on novel in the same name. So what is marketing? So marketing is the purpose of promoting your business to attract consumers towards buying your product or service. Other words, marketing is simply utilizing a set of tools, methods, or strategy to get in front of your customer and convey your brand message. So two common online marketing method or strategy used nowadays are search engine optimization, social media advertisement, and also content in marketing. So purpose of marketing. The purpose of marketing is to generate revenue for a brand, company, or organization. A marketing professional and the teams achieve to throw the execution of strategic digital activities that drive traffic, qualified leads, and sales in direct collaboration with their sales team. So what is the goal of marketing? So the purpose of marketing is to reach your target audience and communicate the benefits of your product or service. So you can successfully acquire, keep, and grow a customer. So your marketing goals must relate the specific business objectives your company wants to achieve. So some types of marketing, social media marketing, content marketing, relationship marketing. So what is skill do you need for marketing? Communication, creative, and problem solving, attention to detail, interpersonal skill, leadership, adaptability, writing, data analysis, and analytics. Project management, social media marketing, email marketing, visual marketing, and website marketing. So what concept of Chetan Bhagat marketing? So my competition is app like Candy Crush or WhatsApp, says Chetan Bhagat. I don't see other writers as my competition at all. I want a share of people's mind. I have to win the theme of YouTube, movie, and apps. So I have to make them interested in books. So he writes for the mass. Most of the people cannot read to save their lives. He writes in simple plain English for which they don't have to refer any dictionary. So much like what Akshay Kumar movies do for you. So you don't have to exercise your mind. So the fact that he incomplete English is something which earn him extra cookie points. So his characters are youngster, maneuvering their way through the labyrinth to successful education system, career world, and relationship problem. So the fact that he uses swear words so often brings in sexual reference in the novel. So add to his charm for the casual reader. So a cultural study approach sometimes concern not only the work that is produced, but also the means of production. So question of how to support the author or of finding a publisher and even of marketing the particular work are German to the culture milieu on which the work is produced. So five things about product marketing you can learn from Chetan Bhagat. There is no such things as bad publicity. Second one is revenue doesn't care if it comes from shameless self promotion. And third one is create your own market. Fourth one is tailor your product and communication to your audience. And fifth one is go for the low high fruit grape. And easy to acquire a customer first. So Chetan Bhagat knows well the purpose of production, marketing, and consumption of anything as has graduated from IIM and IIT. So he knows how best to utilize the culture, milieu, and economical condition of the readers. So he also knows well the demographic of India, the country with most young people. So thus his work of concentrating on youth, so the youth and also price of books elaborate to young pocket in 99 to 150 100 rupees. So here is a marketing use of he was also marketing use of so many tools like a social media, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and personal website, blog, etc. So his work of length of narrative and narrative style, use of a different language, and also he was mention of understanding of his work. His work of also basic tone of Hindutva capitalism, and also sensationalism cells. So here is my work citation. Thank you.
Okay, so that was the last one, and let us have a quick overview of the work throughout the semester. Yes. Okay, so 89.77, that is good percentage, better than the class average. Yes. And you have completed almost all the works also. Yes. None of the works are pending here. Okay, so that is good. And you, in your test, you are coming at this line. Okay? So this line is there. Okay? Yeah. Right at the center, huh? Between the left, right, slightly towards left, but in authoritarian and libertarian, right at the center line, you are there in this compass. Okay, so in this group, now you can call other students also. If anybody is outside, call them, or online also, the others can join for a group photo. Huh? Then we will go for a break, and then we will start another slot. So by the time the others are joining, online or here, in this group, we have very few students whose works are incomplete, yeah, as compared to the morning slot, because in morning slot, we have a lot many students whose works are incomplete. So we'll see that. Here, Pina, one work is incomplete. Stuti, two works. And I hope by tomorrow, you will complete all these things. Then Riti, one. And Nandita, one. Task is incomplete. So by tomorrow, you four of you. Four in this group have one or two tasks incomplete, and by tomorrow I think you will complete the task. Those who are very low than the class average, you will try to see that in the next semester you perform also in a better way. So we have Stuti, lower than the class average, Niyati, Nandita. Yes, these three students are lower than the class average, that is lower than 85% in this group. Okay, so now all are this. So I think those who are present here, you can stand there. Height wise, you stand. Those who are lower height, you stand outside the podium. Those who have the height, that behind the podium. Yes. Sideways, side. This camera will put a little bit farther. Put camera farther so we can see how things will look. Face, keep the flap. Pehle flap band kari do laptop. Okay, you stand, then we will focus this camera, or maybe this camera we can use, then this also will give a better result, I think. This you can put. No, this camera I'm seeing if focus is okay, otherwise we'll take this camera. નહીં એ એમાં કનેક્ટેડ છે ને આ કેમેરો રાખી દે Put this. Don't move this. You still are not properly. This you have to come sideways. You have to come. Just let me make it a little bit front. एक मिनट स्टॉप डोंट टच दिस Still height wise we are not able, so we have to see how it is. Okay, online, who is on this? You can keep cameras off in this, or you can nobody. We will ask some to sit here, face this camera. Three of you can come here. Okay. So three can face the camera here. Okay, three here. How many are online? Online we have this. The camera is not there, so log off from there. From there. Yeah. And. Okay, still this we'll have to, you have to go back, huh? We'll try to put one line, go back, yeah, one line. And just a minute. Okay, online we have Chandni, Jignesh, Hiral, Niyati, Nandita. In Sneha, you have to log in with Kishan. Yes, Kishan, you log in with your Stuti here. In Nidhi, you better replace. Then you log in with your ID. Or you better sit. Yeah, here. Okay, so three are here online. And keep this mic down, that mic little bit down, okay. Mm. be able to get everybody. Okay, online again. We are 10 online. Okay, 10. So 4, 8, 9, and 10. Okay, fine. Yeah. Okay, this a little bit properly. You have to put the camera here. Those who are there, face it properly near. Flap also little bit lower. Nidhi, flap it little bit lower so your face is properly located. Yeah, okay. Online also, you all also check your focus properly. Are you there properly? Let me share the screen what we are seeing here so you all can. I'm sharing the screen so you all can this at least those who are online, they can see that how your face also will be visible in the side window. Okay. This way we are going to get, we will adjust this slightly. I have to. Okay, online students, are you okay now? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9 logged in, 3 from here and 6 are from online. Okay. Because 6, yeah, that is making for the 9 and 3, 8 are here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8. Then anybody is missing? Where is Khushbu? Where is she? Is she outside anywhere? Call her. Huh? One student is missing. One. એમાં નથી બીજું આનું માપ જુદું છે પેલાનું જુદું માપ છે એટલે અચ્છા We have to still a little bit lower. We can get. Okay, is that okay in that frame? Okay, all ready? All online students? લોગ આઉટ થઈ ગયા તમે વન સ્ટુડન્ટ સ્નેહા ઇઝ ગેટિંગ ઇનસાઇડ નાવ થ્રુ ધીસ You can take a that photo also. Screenshot there also you can take. Here, Nidhi. Here and here also. After everybody is ready at that time. Make a full screen. Here, Lata also. Okay, ready everybody? You both can slightly come forward. Go back. Yeah, okay. Now, okay, fine. Yeah. Your head is cutting otherwise. Okay, no, you can stand straight. Yeah, now it is okay. Yeah, one step back you can go. Yeah, okay, yeah. Pina can come forward, slightly forward. Okay, yeah. Okay, all ready then? Okay. Slightly outside. Slightly one. Okay, yeah. Okay, all ready? Yes. All online and all the students here also. I'm taking a screenshot, okay. Just a minute. One more we will take here. Just okay, final one now. Ready, everybody? Yes, all online students, have a look in your camera. Yes, and here also you focus this camera. Here, all the students. Okay, ready? Just a minute. Huh? Okay, now. Yeah, I'm now taking the photo. Okay. You can also take a screenshot there. Are you? This is coming. No problem now. Okay. Then. Okay. Yeah, now we have taken the photo. Okay. When here we will take a photo. You all can stand here. Those are. Okay. Now, online students, we are going to meet. After 20 minutes, we will meet. Okay. After 20 minutes, all online students. We are going to meet, so you join after 20 minutes. Okay, so we have a break for 20 minutes right now. Okay.